Well, Jerome Powell just had his 60 Minutes interview released, and I have to say I'm quite disappointed in Jerome Powell and the Fed, mostly because I didn't get the delicious, juicy finance intel that I generally want from Jerome Powell. Instead, this 60 Minutes interview, which in fairness, it's a primetime broadcast, 7 p.m. Eastern time, for America on a Sunday night. It's a staple in many households. And what did Jerome Powell basically tell households? Hey, we realize that eggs are more expensive, food's more expensive, groceries are more expensive since before the pandemic, and they're probably not going to come down. However, those feelings, the frustration about things being more expensive, is clouding people's outlook of an otherwise strong economy. That's very interesting because Jerome Powell here is basically saying, look, the economy is actually doing very well. In fact, his quote was, the economy is progressing strongly, solid. We have a strong economy. The labor market is strong. The economy is strong. And so now the goal is just determining when do we reduce rates carefully. He also made it clear that they don't really want to get back to the zero lower bound. That makes sense because they generally want to keep rates around 2% at the Fed, so they have room to cut to ZIRP, the zero interest rate policy. But when you get to an effective lower bound known as the ELB, effective lower bound, 0%, you really don't know what happens in an economy if you start pushing rates to negative. So Jerome Powell suggests we want to get back to about 2% on rates. This is probably the first time we've actually had him talk about where they want to see rates end up getting. And that was my takeaway, was they want about 2% of room in there. Now, what's fascinating, and obviously there's no indication how quickly they'll get to that, but what I think is fascinating about that is it really argues for kind of going back to where we were pre-COVID. If you think about it, we had 2% rates before COVID. We went to zero during COVID, but we were at 2.5% on the FOMC rate before COVID. And rates were at historic lows pre-COVID. You know, we're at 3.25% mortgages. Now they fell obviously even more, another about 0.5% into that 2.75 rate on a 30-year mortgage after rates fell to zero thanks to the COVID shock. But that's a tool of the Fed, rapidly cut rates in a recession. Jerome Powell also made it clear that we just shouldn't expect deflation across the board. Yes, some prices might come down, some will come up, but we shouldn't expect broad-based deflation unless we were in some kind of negative economy or negative economic time. A lot of folks look forward to the potential for deflation, but it's important to remember that if our economy, the way it's rigged up, faces deflation, we would actually probably be in a depression. Those are the times we've really experienced extended times of deflation. The 1918, 1919, 1920 era, and then of course the Great Depression, and then maybe about a quarter or so, that is for 3 months in a row, in about 2009. That's when we've experienced deflation. Otherwise, it's always inflation. It's pretty much always inflation because we just run the money printer. If we didn't run the money printer, we would have deflation. Things would be cheaper. The question is, would that be conducive with a growing economy? And that's, of course, where the Austrians and the Keynesians will debate and fight from an economic point of view, but that's beyond the scope of this video. What is interesting is we didn't get any intel on this decline in the average hours worked. I didn't realize this because I thought this was filmed on Friday, but this was filmed on Thursday. So if Jerome Powell started talking jobs in his Thursday interview, then it would just solidify that the jobs report was leaked to him early, which we expect it was, but you know, he doesn't want to make that so obvious. So anyway, he does indicate, as he usually does, the job's not done. As far as the banking crisis, no major concern. He does argue that some banks with higher exposure to toxic assets will close or merge out of existence. Interesting phrase. He did also suggest that bank runs can occur faster today. We saw that during the banking crisis. Everybody gets on social, freaks out, and people leave. That is a way of probably suggesting we need tighter capital requirements because anytime you have a run, boom, bye. Presently, the market is pricing in a 20% chance of cuts in March. Jerome Powell did suggest that we're not convinced that we're going to be ready to cut by March. Market's still sitting at 20%. You probably have to unprice that down to zero unless we get some kind of crazy soft data. But then again, we got our jobs report, which wasn't anywhere near soft. really the next catalysts that we have coming up that are worth considering are this week we're going to have S&P services and composite indices coming out tomorrow on the 5th, along with ISM prices paid at 7 a.m. We'll also get a services index, employment index, new orders index. I'd really like to cover that live in the market open live tomorrow, just so we can compare that to the jobs report to see if they're reiterating each other or if there's some kind of disconnect between the two. We'll get consumer credit on the 7th, nothing on the 6th, and then we'll get initial jobless claims for the week as well as wholesale inventories. But really, we're not going to get much this week other than revisions to CPI on the 9th. And frankly, what will be more interesting will be next week when we get to the 13th. On the 13th, we're looking for CPI, looking for 0.1 on the month over month and 0.3 on the ex food and energy core month over month figure with no estimate yet for the year over year headline, but year over year core looking at 3.7. Something else that I thought was really interesting about Jerome Powell was his suggestion that we don't actually need data that's as good as it has been. In other words, the data has almost been too good, like inflation falling so rapidly on the 6 month. That inflation, you could honestly get a report that's a little worse and they would still probably be comfortable with May cuts. This I thought was fascinating, that they have nearly a fully unanimous group over at the Fed and they see so much inflation in terms of, well, so much inflation declines, the rate of inflation declining so rapidly that they're almost all on the same page that, yeah, look, even if numbers start coming in a little bit warmer, we've made enough progress to where we can begin the process of cutting. I do think they're probably just looking for not only the two reports that we have now, and this is sort of a hedge of his, right? Because if you have two more reports, so you get the January report and the February report, which come out in February and March before the meeting, then they can update their guidance in the summary of economic projections. The economic projections come out with the Federal Reserve meeting, the FOMC meeting on March 20th. And then they can sort of like see how the market reacts to their projections. And then they can decide, do they execute on those projections or do they sort of adjust their projections? So March will really be a messaging meeting. May will probably be our first cut meeting. And then we'll get another messaging meeting thereafter in June. I'll give you the date, meeting calendar of the June meeting. The voiceover from CBS did indicate that rate cuts would come in the middle of the year, which would align with May to June, maybe July, right? That's sort of the middle of the year range there. May 1st, June 12th, and July 31st. Those are your next FOMC press conferences. And the summary of economic projections will be released March 20th, along with June 12th. So this gives you an update on what Jerome Powell just said. We'll have some more updates coming out, and I did post this summary on ehack.com as well, so you're welcome to view that there. It's always free, building an app out for that. That'll be built out in conjunction with what we're working on in terms of app work for House Hack, which is very exciting. We've got some really cool things coming. Stay tuned also for some House Hack updates. There's a chance we might not do anything other than just call for warrants. There's a chance, so stay tuned for that. We might not do a fundraise, might just call for warrants, don't need the money. So that'll be really interesting. I'll have a fuller update on that within the next few days, probably. We'll do some kind of video on the House Hack channel, maybe the main channel. I haven't figured it out yet what we're gonna do, but that's something we've been discussing and what's being sort of what we're leaning towards right now. We wanna get into phase two as soon as possible on House Hack, so it gives you a little sidebar update there. Anyway, thank you so much for watching. Appreciate y'all so much, and we'll see you in the next one.
Why not advertise these things that you told us here? I feel like nobody else knows about this.
We'll try a little advertising and see how it goes.
Congratulations, man. You have done so much. People love you. People look up to you.
Kevin Paffrath there, financial analyst and YouTuber. Meet Kevin. Always great to get your take.
Even though I'm a licensed financial advisor, real estate broker, and becoming a stockbroker, this video is neither personalized financial advice nor real estate advice for you. It is not tax, legal, or otherwise personalized advice tailored to you. This video provides generalized perspective, information, and commentary. Any third-party content I show should not be deemed endorsed by me. This video is not and shall never be deemed reasonably sufficient information for the purpose of evaluating a security or investment decision. Any links or promoted products are either paid affiliations or products or services which we may benefit from. I personally operate an actively managed ETF and hold long positions in various securities, potentially including those mentioned in this video. However, I have no relationship to any issuers other than House Hack, nor am I presently acting as a market maker.